High Bridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents A House Full of Females, Plural Marriage and Women's Rights in Early Mormonism, 1835 to 1870, by Laurel Thatcher Ulrich, read by Susan Ericksen. Organize yourselves. Prepare every needful thing, and establish a house, even a house of prayer, a house of fasting, a house of faith, a house of learning, a house of glory, a house of order, a house of God. Doctrine and Covenants of the Church of the Latter-day Saints, Kirkland, Ohio, 1835. The house was full of females, quilting, sewing, etc. Wilford Woodruff Diary, Salt Lake City, Territory of Utah, 1857. The records of this house shall prove we're neither slack nor slow. Eliza Roxy Snow, Hymn for the Dedication of the 15th Ward Relief Society Hall, 1869. Introduction. An Indignation Meeting. Salt Lake City, Utah Territory, 1870. Light snow obscured the view of the mountains on January 13, 1870, as masses of Mormon women crowded into the old peaked-roof tabernacle in Salt Lake City. The pine benches were hard, the pot-bellied stoves inadequate against the cold. No matter. They would warm themselves with indignation. The news had come by telegraph a week before. The much-feared Cullum Bill had passed the United States House of Representatives. If the Senate concurred, the government would soon have the power to confiscate Mormon property, deprive wives of immunity as witnesses, and imprison their husbands. This wasn't the first time Congress had attempted to outlaw the Mormon marriage system. Calls for federal action had begun 14 years before with the Republican Party platform of 1856, which linked polygamy in Utah and slavery in the South as twin relics of barbarism. Representative Justice S. Morrill of Vermont enunciated the essential argument. Under the guise of religion, this people has established and seek to maintain and perpetuate a Mohammedan barbarism revolting to the civilized world. Novelists and the new illustrated weeklies took up the chorus, linking Utahns not only with the southern slaveholders, but with Turks, Africans, and Indians on both sides of the world. Although Congress responded by passing an anti-polygamy statute in 1861, there was little hope of enforcement in the midst of the Civil War. Now, with Reconstruction underway in the South, reformers decided to try again. Arguing that Utah women were slaves to a system worse than death, they scoffed at the sickly sentimentality which proposes to punish nobody, which proposes to hang nobody, which proposes to let all the unchained passions of the human heart become free to prey upon mankind. What nonsense! Eliza Snow exclaimed from the platform of the old tabernacle. She and other leaders among Salt Lake City women had acted quickly to organize an indignation meeting, a well-recognized form of protest in the 19th century United States. Indignation was more than anger. It was sympathetic outrage directed at an injustice. The goal was publicity in its broadest sense. Cleverly banning all males except the press, they showcased their most effective speakers. Amanda Smith, widowed years before by anti-Mormon mobs in Missouri, brought tears to her listeners' eyes as she repeated the story of her suffering. Hannah King, an English immigrant, asked, "Are we really in America? The world-renowned land of liberty, of freedom, of equal rights, the land of which I dreamed in my youth, where freedom of thought and religious liberty were enjoyed by all?" Eleanor Pratt said she had been turned out of doors for her faith and would willingly give her life for it. Phoebe Woodruff warned that if Congress chose to imprison Mormon men, they would have to make their prisons large enough to hold their wives, for where they go, we will go also. The reporter for the New York Herald, disgusted at the sight of infatuated females speaking in favor of a system repugnant to women of finer feelings, nevertheless produced a full-page account of the speeches. The San Francisco Evening Bulletin pronounced the meeting one of the most remarkable, perhaps, that has ever congregated on the continent. To see a mass of between 3,000 and 4,000 women, nearly all Anglo-Saxon, many of them American-born and raised, meeting together to advocate the claims of polygamy and defend the men who practice it, is food for reflection and moralizing. For the Daily Cleveland Herald, the explanation was obvious. The women were as strongly attached to their peculiar and unpopular faith as the men can be. The Mormon-dominated legislature in Utah soon demonstrated their confidence in their wives and sisters by passing a bill granting women the vote. Although the question of woman suffrage had been raised in Washington during debates over granting rights of citizenship to freed slaves, only the most radical among Eastern reformers were prepared to embrace it. When the tiny Wyoming legislature passed a woman suffrage bill in December 1869, most people considered it a stunt, since there were so few white inhabitants in Wyoming territory and six times as many males as females. The situation in Utah was different. Females composed a slight majority of the territory's 86,000 non-native residents. Ironically, the idea of enfranchising Utah women first appeared in a New York Times article, the writer surmising that if women were empowered, they would eliminate polygamy. No one imagined they would stand up and defend it. And what is the use of woman suffrage if it is to be used to bolster up an institution so degrading to the sex and demoralizing to society? Concluded a reporter from New Jersey. The spectacle in Utah soon attracted the attention of Elizabeth Cady Stanton and Susan B. Anthony, two of the most powerful advocates for woman suffrage. Still smarting over the refusal of Congress to embrace their cause, they added Utah to the itinerary for a journey west in 1871. After several days in Salt Lake City, Stanton told the press that antagonists on the Mormon question had missed the point. Polygamy and monogamy were both oppressive systems. She argued that those who opposed the Latter-day Saints were every bit as befuddled as the saints themselves. The condition of women is slavery today, and must be so long as they are shut out of the world of work, helpless dependence on man for bread. She was nevertheless pleased that Utah women had the vote. Eventually, she accepted polygamous wives as allies. Mormon women responded by becoming ardent members of Stanton's movement. For 40 years, the Woman's Exponent, founded in 1872, advocated for the rights of the women of Zion and the rights of the women of all nations. The emergence of Utah women as political actors was so remarkable, so unexpected, that even today it is often dismissed as an anomaly, one of those strange events so out of the mainstream as to defy explanation. The word paradox appears again and again in books and articles dealing with the topic. How could women simultaneously support a national campaign for political and economic rights, while defending marital practices that to most people seemed relentlessly patriarchal? At one level, the answer is obvious. Their own community was threatened. By standing up as women, they defended their homes and their religious identity. But that explanation is too simple. If an Eastern newspaper dropped a match that ignited a woman's rights movement in Utah in 1870, the fuel for that blaze had been accumulating for years. Utah may have looked like an old-world patriarchy with its biblical terminology, theocratic government, and retreat into a valley with a Dead Sea and a River Jordan. But those who migrated there had been touched by the radical energies of the 1830s and 1840s. By the time the Mormons arrived in Utah, female as well as male leaders knew how to circulate petitions, sign affidavits, lobby public officials, and employ the power of the press. By embracing Mormonism, the leaders of the indignation meeting had already shown a willingness to push against the grain. Some had abandoned homes, families, and legal husbands in order to do so. They were religious seekers who, before becoming Latter-day Saints, had been Methodists, Quakers, Anglicans, Campbellites, and everything in between. As Latter-day Saints, they had experimented with health reform, dress reform, and communitarianism. Some practiced, even if they did not yet preach, forms of sex radicalism, the idea that a woman should choose when and with whom she would bear children. Their indignation emerged from religious passion, from a yearning for millennial justice, from the experience of being hounded and driven from place to place, and from the frustration of vainly petitioning judges, governors, and presidents for redress. As Latter-day Saints, they were victims of ignorant and sometimes willful misrepresentation by outsiders, but they were surely exaggerating when they claimed they had experienced nothing but liberty in Utah. As their own writings attest, they had endured both condescension and open opposition from church leaders. By 1870, they had demonstrated their facility as organizers by banding together to solve problems in Utah and by rebuilding the Female Relief Society, a women's voluntary society founded in Nauvoo, Illinois in 1842 and dissolved by Brigham Young in 1845. They planned their indignation meeting in a newly dedicated Relief Society Hall that had an upper floor for meetings and a lower one for selling goods created through cooperative labor. Without question, Congress's attempt to outlaw polygamy outraged them, but it also strengthened their position within their own community as they rose in its defense. Their support for their brethren was sincere, but it was also strategic. They knew when and how to ask for the things that they wanted, and they wanted the right to vote. When the woman's suffrage bill passed, they quickly appointed a committee to thank the territory's acting governor, a non-Mormon, for signing it, then went about teaching citizenship to women in outlying parts of the territory. The history of The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints typically focuses on its founding prophets, Joseph Smith, who in 1830 published the Book of Mormon, and then, over the next decade, established communities in Ohio, Missouri, and Illinois, and Brigham Young, who, after Smith's murder in 1844, led the largest faction of Latter-day Saints to the Rocky Mountains. Smith and Young were powerful and charismatic leaders, but Mormonism, like other religious movements, flourished because it attracted strong women. Collectively, the 29 leaders of the indignation meeting had experienced the entire history of the church from its founding in upstate New York in 1830 through the epic migration to Utah. Two-thirds of them had become Latter-day Saints before Smith's death. All but two had arrived in Utah by 1855. If there was a Mormon culture in the territory in 1870, they had helped create it. They came from Cambridgeshire, Wiltshire, Kent, Devon, and Oxfordshire in England, from Wales, Scotland, and Upper Canada, and from the states of Georgia, South Carolina, Virginia, Pennsylvania, New Jersey, Massachusetts, New York, Maine, and Vermont. Few had stayed long in one place. Eliza Snow, though born in western Massachusetts, grew up in Ohio. Eleanor Pratt, a Virginian, met Mormon missionaries in San Francisco, Mary McKinn in Philadelphia, and Harriet Cook in Boston. Mary Isabella Horn started life in England, migrated to Canada, and then, as an early convert, joined the Saints in Ohio. Phoebe Woodruff worked as a teacher and dressmaker in coastal Maine before migrating to Ohio. Later, she lived with her missionary husband in Lancashire, England, and in Boston. Well before plural marriage became a recognized practice in the church, these women had learned to value bonds of faith over biological or regional connections. I am proud to say to you that I am not only a citizen of the United States of America, but a citizen of the Kingdom of God, Wilmerth East exclaimed from the pulpit of the old tabernacle. Jealous of their rights as Americans, even if born outside the United States, they did not want to be rescued by those who neither understood nor valued their faith. When Harriet Cook claimed both the rights of American citizenship and the privilege of marrying a husband of her choice, she was defending polygamy. All of the speakers stood up for the practice, even if they had not lived it. Sarah Kimball, who presided over the meeting, had never been a plural wife, nor had Amanda Smith or Hannah Tapfield King. Yet all three embraced plurality as a theological concept. The reporter from San Francisco found the sight of several thousand women becoming advocates for polygamy food for reflection and moralizing. Today, the same phenomenon offers food for historical investigation. Others have written and will continue to write about what happened after Utah women won the vote. This book focuses on the decades-long struggle that brought them to that point. It explores the pathways they traveled from monogamy to polygamy and from urban boarding houses, Midwestern farms, and English cottages to the slant-roofed old tabernacle in Salt Lake City. It asks why so many women, nearly all Anglo-Saxon, were willing to defend a system others considered degrading. Plural marriage, as the saints called it, emerged gradually and in secret in Nauvoo, Illinois, the utopian city the saints built on the banks of the Mississippi River after being driven from Missouri. Joseph Smith took his first plural wife in the spring of 1841, and over the next 3 years was sealed to more than 24 women. The exact number is uncertain. One historian refers to these early sealings as proto-polygamy. Proto meaning giving rise to or being ancestral to distinguish it from the later, more developed practice. The Female Relief Society also developed in Nauvoo. In a meeting above his red brick store, Smith promised he would make of the society a kingdom of priests as in Enoch's day, as in Paul's day. Within 2 years, it had more than 1,300 members devoted to poor relief and support for construction of a massive temple. Shortly before his death, Joseph and his legal wife, Emma Hale Smith, prepared a select group of women and men to officiate in temple ceremonies, even though the temple itself was not yet complete. Polygamy and temple rituals flourished in the months after Smith's death. The Relief Society did not. When Emma Smith, who was its president, rejected Brigham Young as her husband's successor, he disbanded it. Although most of its members followed Young to Utah, roughly 15% stayed behind, among them Emma Smith, who raised her children to believe that their father had never had other wives. Thus, at the heart of the succession from Smith to Young was a division in the female community. Eliza Snow, who had been one of Smith's plural wives, carried the Relief Society Minute Book with her to Utah. In the years to come, she used it to remind her closest associates of the promises they had received in Nauvoo. For Latter-day Saints, plurality was not just a social system. It was a means of salvation. Joseph Smith shocked his contemporaries by teaching that human intelligences, he used the plural form, were co-eternal with God. Moreover, all the spirits that God ever sent into the world are susceptible to enlargement. Enlargement included but was by no means limited to biological reproduction. In a poem written to a female friend, Eliza Snow portrayed individual affinities as nodes in an interlocking web that connected noble spirits across the earth and from earth to heaven, and still extending on from world to world, unto creation's undefined extent. To her, it did not matter whether a woman was the only wife or one among many, since all the righteous would eventually be bound together. She insisted that spiritual bonds produced a holier feeling than friendship, witnessing the possibility of an eternal network of souls twined and intertwined, combining and combined. After Joseph Smith's death, Eliza Snow joined Brigham Young's household. In 1870, she was living with a dozen of his other wives in the Lion House, a gabled structure on South Temple Street that took its name from a stone lion that stood over the door. Although outsiders referred to it as Brigham's harem, it could also have been described as an experiment in cooperative housekeeping and an incubator of female activism. For years, Zena D.H. Young, who gave the prayer at the indignation meeting, lived across the hall from Eliza. Harriet Cook Young, one of the more flamboyant speakers at the meeting, lived two doors down. As an architectural structure, the Lion House was unique. Most polygamous wives lived in houses that, whether large or small, looked like vernacular dwellings found elsewhere in the United States. Yet the concept of female cooperation was widespread. Mormonism reinforced and at the same time transformed patterns of association common to rural societies everywhere. Women banded together to spin, weave, and care for the sick, but also to participate in sacred rituals. The defining concept was not plural marriage, but gathering, a belief that those who accepted the faith had a duty to join their fellow believers in building a new Zion. Plural marriage was pervasive, but far from universal. Although by 1860 more than 40% of the territory's inhabitants, men, women, and children, lived in plural households, the composition of those households varied widely. Two-thirds of polygamist husbands had only two wives. Another 20% had three. Those who had four or more were often members of high church councils or bishops of local congregations, and, as in any society, birth, death, and migration reshaped families. Over time, a monogamist might embrace polygamy, or a polygamist, through death or divorce, find himself with one wife or none. A small oil painting completed in central Utah in 1872 portrays the interior of an ordinary Utah house shortly after the birth of a baby. The midwife and several female attendants have tucked the new mother into bed and are now weighing the infant. This is a classic gathering of women performing classic female work. There is nothing in the painting to tell us that the woman in the bed is 29-year-old Gunhild Torgeson Dorius, who has just given birth to a son named Hiram. Nor, without family records, could we know that she and Kyla Franzen Dorius, the tall woman in the center of the picture, were both married to the man at the door, Frederick Ferdinand Dorius, a Danish immigrant who was a friend of the painter, C.C.A. Christensen. Gunhild and Kaya were plural wives who belonged to a more expansive sisterhood built through spiritual, social, and economic associations. In all likelihood, the midwife who was weighing the baby was empowered to bless and anoint the mother, as well as to officiate at the birth. Years later, a granddaughter remembered Gunhild as a quiet, gentle little lady who carded and spun her own wool for cloth and believed polygamy to be a sacred principle. When visitors came, she pointed with pride to a picture of her husband dressed in prison stripes with other Mormon men incarcerated during the anti-polygamy raids of the late 19th century. She said his imprisonment proved that he loved her because he could have avoided prosecution by renouncing their marriage. To outsiders, the Lion House represented the Gothic strangeness of Mormonism. To an insider like CCA Christensen, the Dorius House represented its comforting familiarity. Both kinds of houses were part of the Mormon story, as were the public buildings where Latter-day Saint women engaged in collaborative work and eventually in political protest. On a winter day in 1857, a 50-year-old Mormon apostle named Wilford Woodruff visited the 14th Ward Meeting House in Salt Lake City. In his diary, he noted, "The house was full of females, quilting, sewing, etc." Wilford had three wives and was about to acquire a fourth. His own house was full of females. But this gathering was different. Sometimes as many as 50 women assembled for meetings of the Ward Relief Society. His first wife, Phoebe, was its president. Remarkably, one of the quilts its members were making has recently been found. Completed in the autumn of 1857, it was later sold at a raffle. The man who won it cut it down the middle, years later, and gave one half to each of his two grown daughters. They and their heirs passed it on until no one was quite sure where their own piece had come from and what had happened to the other. Brought together in 2004, the two halves, only slightly damaged by time, reveal the signatures in ink and in thread of the 67 women who made it. Phoebe's autograph appears on one half, her appliqued fruit and flowers on the other. The sundering and reuniting of the quilt offers a metaphor for the losses and recoveries that characterize women's history. This book is a kind of quilt, an attempt to find an underlying unity in the collection of fragments. Because I want to understand early Mormonism from the perspective of those who embraced it, I have chosen to focus on diaries and other day-by-day records, such as letters, occasional poetry, and minutes of meetings. Some historians silently merge documents like these with autobiographies and memoirs written decades later. I have not done that. Retrospective accounts are valuable, but they have to be understood in relation to the conflicts and commemorations that produce them. Since every word written about early Mormonism was and is controversial, it is important to know when as well as what people wrote. This is not to say that diaries are more truthful than memoirs, just better at conveying the instability of events as they unfolded. Diarists did not know how things would turn out. When Wilford Woodruff began keeping a diary in 1835, not only were there few Mormon diarists, there were few Mormons. Over his lifetime, he did his best to change both of those things. Remembered as a prodigious missionary, he also preached the gospel of diary keeping. In March 1857, he told a gathering of Mormon leaders, "I have kept a journal of almost every day of my life for the last 24 years. I could tell each day what I had done, what company I was in, and what was transpiring around me." He admitted that this had been a lot of work. "But what of it?" he continued. "I have never spent any of my time more profitably for the benefit of mankind than in my journal writing." It would be hard for a modern-day historian to disagree. Woodruff's meticulous record, over 5,000 pages in typescript, is a powerful account of 19th-century Mormonism. It is also a great American diary. He once told a group of Mormon missionaries that he did not care whether they wrote down what they ate or drank unless they were fed in a desert by ravens like the prophet Elijah. If that happened, they should record it. Otherwise, they could ignore mundane things. Fortunately, he did not follow his own advice. While visiting with Phoebe's relatives on the coast of Maine, he even jotted down directions for making a chowder. Perhaps he realized that it wasn't always possible to distinguish ephemeral from enduring things. As he told the missionaries, "We are not apt to think of the importance of events as they transpire with us, but we feel the importance of them afterwards." That may be why his diaries are so much more interesting than his memoirs, especially for understanding women's history, which often depends on recovering things later deemed unimportant, like a gathering of women's quilting and sewing. The steady dailiness of Woodruff's diaries helps link smaller and more intermittent pieces left by others. One scholar has estimated that, in Mormon archives, men's diaries and memoirs outnumber those of women by 10 to 1. That may actually underestimate the problem. Although limited education may have contributed to the scarcity of women's writing, a more important factor was the cultural assumption that their words, like their duties, were essentially private and therefore beyond the reach of history. Men, not women, routinely served missions, and diary keeping was a missionary duty. Missionaries commonly wrote in bound journals. In contrast, female diarists often used the blank pages of other people's diaries, homemade packets stitched together from folded paper, children's school books, and in one case, the back of old maps. In archives, their words often fade into the page as though they had been exposed to rain, sun, and sleet, if not a laundry tub. Some pages are overlaid with the scribblings of children. Eliza R. Snow, Zena D. H. Young, and Bathsheba Smith were prominent leaders in 19th century Utah, yet their personal journals, like the 14th Ward quilt, almost disappeared. In the 1940s, the diary Eliza began in Nauvoo narrowly escaped a bonfire when the collateral relative, who inherited it, died without heirs. Fortunately, a neighbor helping to clean out her house looked inside the corrugated cardboard box where the diary had been stashed, thought it looked interesting, kept it for a while, and then passed it along to a friend who had an interest in history. Almost by accident, it found a place in Latter-day Saint archives. Another of Eliza's diaries found its way to California, where it became part of the collections of the Huntington Library. One cache of Zena Young's papers rested for years in a red tin bread box she had brought from Nauvoo. In the late 20th century, a great-granddaughter rediscovered it in the basement of her mother's house while looking for Christmas decorations. Other relatives found documents hidden behind the log walls of a pioneer house in Canada. Later, a great-great-granddaughter found more materials in a locked trunk she had been using as a sofa table but had not been able to open. These documents eventually found a home in the Church History Library in Salt Lake City. In their acid-free folders, the more fragile among them looked like the tattered remnants of old lace. Bathsheba Smith kept her Overland Trail diary in a hand-me-down journal. She or someone else cut out the earlier pages, leaving a ragged residue along the spine. Years later, a granddaughter dropped this mutilated document into a protective bag stitched out of cotton drapery fabric. Another descendant added a scrap of paper explaining the origin of the bag, but not the diary. Eventually, a third person deposited the whole package in special collections at the University of Utah under the name of Bathsheba's husband, George Smith, noting that it had been passed from Bathsheba to a granddaughter named Merrill, and then Fisher to a great-granddaughter named Affleck. At any stage in this complex journey, the diary itself or its association with its creator could have been lost. Records can, of course, survive without being read or understood. The ledger in which Eliza kept the minutes of the Nauvoo Relief Society is arguably one of the most important documents in Latter-day Saint history. She carried it with her when she left Nauvoo, consulted it, discussed it with others, and after 1867, used it to establish the pattern for Relief Society minute books kept throughout Utah. When Bathsheba Smith became general president of the Relief Society in 1901, she cared for the ledger. In 1911, after her death, her daughter presented it to the church archives, where it was seldom consulted by scholars until the feminist revival in the 1970s. Because some of the passages appeared to contradict well-established ideas about female access to priesthood, church leaders carefully controlled its use. The full minutes have only recently been published in a scholarly edition. In any field, the writings of ordinary people alter descriptions of the past. In the 19th century, as today, Mormon theology celebrated the eternity of the marriage covenant and the sacred meaning of families. But Mormon ideas about marriage and families have changed remarkably over time. If plural wives stood up for their church in the 1870s, it was not just because pioneering had made them strong, but because the concept of gathering that was at the heart of Mormon theology taught them that retreating into a private haven was neither possible nor righteous. They wanted to change the world, and they believed God had shown them a way to do it. In that, they were much like other Americans who had their boots in prairie mud and their heads in the stars. They remind us that common men and women, like the prophets they revered, dreamed dreams and saw visions. Mormon diarists loved God and their fellow saints. They also embraced sentimental poetry, phrenology, and the herb lobelia, brass bands, mechanical gadgets, and speaking in tongues. While waiting for the second coming of Jesus, they filed claims to frontier land and laid out street plans. Their newspapers published advertisements for daguerreotypists and itinerant painters as well as sermons. And on the Overland Trail, as well as in every settlement they established, they struck up the fiddle and danced. In an 1853 sermon, Wilford Woodruff told a group of male leaders, "Should we ever have the privilege in our resurrected bodies of visiting other planets and the inhabitants of the same, we should want to learn the history of that people. If they had kept no records of their lives and the dealings of gods with them so we could get their history, we should feel much disappointed. So would they should they visit us." For those who find the past not just a foreign country, but a different planet, records matter. The writings of early Latter-day Saints expose their peculiar values. They also reveal the many things they shared with those who considered them aliens. 1. Wonder on wonder strikes my sense. Ohio, Connecticut, and Maine, 1836 to 1838. Walking toward Kirtland, Ohio, in late November 1836, Wilford Woodruff caught sight of the temple standing on a bluff above the flats. When he left Kirtland 2 years before, the temple had been only a dream. Now it rose before him, more magnificent, he thought, than kings ever saw or princes ever knew. His excitement grew as he entered the village. In 1834, the little band of Latter-day Saints in Ohio had been poor and despised by their neighbors. Now there were signs of progress everywhere. He and his companion, a Kentuckian named Abraham Smoot, lost no time in touring the temple, from the light-filled assembly rooms on the lower levels to the offices in the attic where Joseph Smith kept the Egyptian mummies and fragments of papyri that he said contained the writings of the biblical Abraham. Wonder on wonder strikes my sense to look into the casket of the great works of Israel's God in these last days, Wilford wrote. For a newly settled town in Ohio's Western Reserve, the building was indeed impressive. Sited on the highest point of land in the region, it had a soaring sanctuary on each of its main floors and a polychrome tower reaching to the sky. Some said that on a clear day, visitors to the tower could see across Lake Erie to Canada. Color added to the building's glory. The roof was a deep brick red, the exterior walls a glistening gray-blue created by grinding broken glass and cobalt-glazed ceramics into the stucco, then painting lines to simulate stonework. Two olive-green doors opened into the interior. A model of Yankee ingenuity and rural pretension, the temple had Greek pilasters and Gothic windows, ascending pulpits on both ends of the major rooms, movable seats in the pews, and adjustable curtains operated by pulleys to subdivide the spaces. Red velvet drapery ornamented the pulpits. Latter-day Saints believed God, speaking through Joseph Smith, had commanded them to build the temple. Smith's revelation called it a house of prayer, a house of fasting, a house of faith, a house of learning, a house of glory, a house of order, a house of God. At its dedication in March 1836, some heard the sound of a mighty wind as a pillar of light descended. Others saw angels soaring through the windows to settle on the high pulpits. It was a house of glory built by ordinary folk. Bolstered by contributions gathered by missionaries like Wilford, its construction provided work for common laborers as well as for skilled carpenters like Brigham Young. God may have prescribed the dimensions of the building, but human beings quarried the stone, planed the planks, stitched the draperies, and constructed the window mullions and sashes using carpenters' manuals and Smith's visions for their guide. On his first Sunday back in the town, Wilford stood in one of the pulpits and reported on his mission. He took as his text a passage in Isaiah about God's power to graft into the house of Israel even the son of the stranger. Wilford was talking about the men and women he had baptized in Kentucky and Tennessee. He was also talking about himself. The scripture promised, "Even unto them will I give in mine house and within my walls a place and a name better than of sons and of daughters. I will give them an everlasting name that shall not be cut off." Like many New Englanders of his generation, Wilford had migrated west in search of new opportunities. Now, nearly 30, he had neither a wife nor a home of his own. But in Kirtland, he had a place of honor in God's house. Soon, though he did not yet know it, he would find a wife, a resolute New Englander named Phoebe Carter. Together, they would begin a journey that would take them to their old homes in Connecticut and Maine, and then to the Fox Islands off the Atlantic coast to gather others, relatives and strangers, into a faith that promised wonders on wonders. The First Book of Wilford. Born in Connecticut in 1807, Wilford was the youngest of Aphek and Beulah Woodruff's three children, all boys. When he was just a year old, his mother died in the midst of a spotted fever epidemic that also claimed his grandfather. When Wilford was not yet three, his father married Azubah Hart, who gave birth to six more children, five boys and a girl. Azubah's boys were haunted by death. Julius died shortly after birth, Franklin at 3 months, Newton drowned at 2. 16-year-old Philo fell ill after dreaming that there would soon be a funeral in the family. His death provoked Wilford, who was then 20, to consider his own spiritual state. He asked a local Baptist preacher to baptize him by immersion, but he did not join any church. After a short stint at the Farmington Academy, his family could not afford more, he moved with his older brother Asmum to a farm in upstate New York. When Mormon missionaries came through in 1833, both accepted baptism. In 1834, Wilford, the more zealous convert, headed to Ohio to meet Joseph Smith. There he joined Zion's Camp, a quasi-military expedition sent to relieve Mormon settlers who had been driven from their homes in Jackson County, Missouri. From there, he accepted a call to serve as a missionary in Tennessee and Kentucky. During his 2 years in the backcountry, he supported himself by selling subscriptions to the Latter-day Saints Messenger and Advocate, performing day labor, and accepting food, lodging, and cash donations from church members and strangers. One of Joseph Smith's revelations assured newly called missionaries that whatsoever they shall speak when moved upon by the Holy Ghost shall be scripture. Wilford took those words seriously. He learned to preach, and he learned to keep a diary, labeling his 4x6 leather-bound journal the First Book of Wilford. At first, he wrote in a loose, almost unformed scrawl, taking rough notes that he later transcribed, first in cursive, then in a kind of Roman print that appeared to imitate type. To make it easier to find things, he began setting off certain entries with special symbols or borders, using the calligraphy skills he had acquired during his short time at school. Thanks to his end-of-year summaries, we know that during his 2-year mission, he traveled 6,557 miles, held 153 meetings, participated in 4 debates, baptized 27 persons, blessed 19 children, healed 4 persons, and escaped from 3 mobs. The mobs were an affirmation of his calling. Hadn't the ancient apostles also suffered opposition? At a place he called Bloody Creek, Kentucky, he gave a full page to a dream or vision of the sun going dark and the moon turned to blood and the horizon covered with burning cities as prophesied in Scripture. He then saw the resurrection of Jesus and witnessed the joy of members of the Church of the Firstborn clothed in white. Words were not enough to describe such an experience. He ornamented his page with tiny sketches of the things he had seen. When he returned to Kirtland late in 1836, he expected even more powerful manifestations of God's presence. He enrolled in something called the School of the Prophets, an adult education program for Mormon preachers, where he learned a smattering of Latin, Greek, and Hebrew. Between January and May of 1837, he attended evening meetings of the Quorum of 70s, a group of men with special callings to preach. He participated in private feasts, during which food was distributed to the poor, and in blessing meetings, where Joseph Smith's father, who had been called as church patriarch, laid his hands on the heads of members to offer consolation, affirmation of lineage in the house of Israel, and the promise of future redemption. When Father Smith blessed Abraham Smoot, Wilford served as scribe, taking down the blessing in his neat Roman hand. For Wilford, the most important gatherings occurred within the temple. Here he would listen to Joseph Smith and the apostles speak and participate in holy rituals. The prophet had already adopted the Christian practice of washing feet, but in 1836 he reached backward to the book of Exodus, building on a passage that described Moses bringing Aaron and his sons to the door of the tabernacle of the congregation for a special washing and anointing that allowed them to minister as priests. On April 4, 1837, Wilford and 22 other men gathered at a private home and washed themselves with clean water and perfumes before repairing to the temple for an anointing. Although the Old Testament recipe called for myrrh, sweet cinnamon, calamus, and cassia, the saints made do with cinnamon. After anointing, Wilford joined two other men in a veiled space in the temple. They knelt in prayer and, in Wilford's words, vowed that they would not give sleep to our eyes, neither take food, until we received a blessing from God by the outpourings of His Spirit upon us, if it was until the end of 3 days. Alternately praying and contending with the fatigue they associated with Satan, they continued through the night. Then, having gained a good degree of victory over the devil, they left the temple to return that evening for another round. In contrast to the elaborate vision he had recorded in Kentucky, Wilford measured the success of this experience not by a visual manifestation, but by the peace he felt. "The Spirit of God sat upon us, and we were satisfied with our blessing." Years later, a church leader who had been in Kirtland said that when Joseph Smith introduced the ritual of washing and anointing to male leaders, some women got right huffy about it, feeling that they had been left out. If so, they neglected to record their complaints. Their memoirs recall spiritual manifestations, such as an outpouring of glossolalia or speaking in tongues. Some heard an invisible choir during services in the temple. One young mother claimed that her 6-month-old baby slept quietly through the 7-hour dedication ceremony, then joined the crowd in shouting, "Hosanna!" The completion of the temple nevertheless marked a subtle transition in Latter-day Saint worship, which had previously focused on small gatherings in homes. In Kirtland, Elizabeth Ann and Newell Whitney often hosted feasts for the poor, like the ones Wilford attended, occasions when guests fasted for 2 meals, then brought butter, bread, and other foods to share with the needy. When held in the temple, fast days like these took on a more formal quality. On March 23, 1837, Wilford arrived early and retired to a veiled area with several other elders for prayer. As the crowd gathered, he emerged into the main space where, at the invitation of the prophet's father, he read a passage from the Book of Mormon while the congregation stood. When the curtains dropped, dividing the room into 4 parts, the females occupied 2 parts and the males the others. Male leaders presided in each of the divisions as people engaged in singing, exhortation, and prayer. Some had a tongue, others an interpretation, and all was in order. The reference to order is significant. Joseph Smith had been shocked when he first arrived in Kirtland by the extremes of enthusiasm that greeted him. The temple became a setting for encouraging and at the same time containing ecstatic expression. With the room divided, 4 times as many people had an opportunity to participate, But the presence of a member of the presidency in each group prevented things from getting out of hand. Wilford explained that, after the separate meetings, the veils were all rolled up together, which brought the whole congregation in full view of each other, and while the presence of the Lord filled the house, the congregation of the saints fell upon their knees, and all as one man vocally poured forth rejoicing, supplication, and prayer before the God of Israel. Presumably, the phrase "one man" included women, though we cannot be sure. Movable seats in the pews allowed people to face pulpits on either the east or the west side as required. The pulpits themselves ascended in four levels, with three stations in each. Those on the west held the presidencies of the Melchizedek, or the higher priesthood. Those on the east, the Aaronic, or lesser. With eight presidencies and 24 men involved, authority was both widely distributed and hierarchically ordered. Joseph Smith and his two counselors commanded the top tier in the Melchizedek pulpit. While Wilford filled his diary with details about temple worship, something else was happening unnoticed. In early April, he set off a blank space with a distinct border and reported dryly, "My first acquaintance with Miss Phoebe W. Carter was on the evening of the 28th of January, 1837, at which time I was introduced to her at Elder Milliken's by the politeness of Elder M. Holmes. After 2.5 months' acquaintance, we were joined in matrimony." In the midst of religious ecstasy, he had found a wife. To leave my paternal roof. Phoebe Carter was born on March 8, 1807, in Scarborough, Maine, a coastal town south of Portland. She was just 7 days younger than Wilford, and at the age of 30, a true peer, having embraced the Latter-day Saint gospel wholeheartedly and on her own. Unlike him, she had grown up in a house full of females. When Mormon missionaries came through Scarborough in 1834, Phoebe's younger sisters, Rhoda, Shua, and Mary, all in their 20s, were still at home, and the one married sister, Sarah Foss, lived nearby. In the minority were the three brothers, Ezra, Fabian, and Illis. Like many young women of her generation, Phoebe had worked off and on as a teacher and a dressmaker. In a period when an increasing number of women remained single, she must have wondered whether it would be her lot to live and die in the big house where she had been born. Almost as soon as she was baptized, she contemplated moving, or gathering, to Kirtland. Believing that the second coming of Jesus was imminent, missionaries taught that newly baptized members had a duty to migrate to the Mormon Zion to become the first laborers in this last kingdom. Although hundreds of New England women left home to work in nearby textile mills or teach in a rural school, very few set off alone to join a religious community 700 miles away. Phoebe's family opposed her plan, and when it came time to leave, she was too overcome with emotion to say goodbye in person. Instead, she composed a letter for them to read once she was out of sight. That the letter survived suggests that her family cherished it. Written in a neat and legible hand on two long sheets of cream-colored paper, it displayed a better-than-average education, a mastery of religious rhetoric, and significantly less sentimentality than Wilford's writing. "Beloved parents," she began, "I am now about to leave my paternal roof for a while, but I know not how long, but not without grateful feelings for the kindness which I have received from my infancy until the present time." There are no protestations of love in this opening, just a straightforward statement of the situation. She appreciated all her parents had done for her, but she wanted them to know that it was time for them to part. Providence had willed it thus. That she began to write parental, then shifted to paternal roof, may reflect an inbred sense that houses belong to fathers. The change also hints at her bookishness. Although the phrase paternal roof was common in both fiction and poetry between 1800 and 1840, the term parental roof was seldom used before the 20th century. To Phoebe, it probably didn't have quite the right ring. Shifting in the next sentence from I to the collective pronouns us and we allowed her to transform a personal dilemma into a generic struggle between doubt and faith. Let us commit all these things into the hands of Providence and be thankful that we have been permitted to live together so long under so favorable circumstances as we have, believing that all things will work for our good if we love God supremely. And what did it mean to love God supremely? Almost despite herself, Phoebe shifted from a classic invocation of Providence to an assertion of her own right to revelation, though she muted her argument by maintaining that distancing we. Let us realize that we can pray to one God who will hear the sincere prayers of all his creatures and give us that which is best for us. Phoebe had listened to the missionaries when they pointed to the passage in the Book of Mormon that enjoined all those who received the book to pray sincerely and ask God if it was true. She knew she should gather with the saints. She also recognized that it was time to prepare for Christ's second coming and for the great millennium to come. May we strive to have that spirit in us that raised Christ from the dead, that our mortal bodies may be quickened and come forth in the morn of the first resurrection to reign with Christ 1,000 years, where parting will be no more. Glorious thought! May it ever stimulate us to be diligent in keeping all the commands of God and not count our trials here too much to gain such a prize. Her preaching was measured but clear. Her pain was also palpable. At the end of her letter, she stepped down from her literary pulpit to address directly the parent who had obviously been the chief opponent of her leaving, the person who, as she explained years later in a short autobiography, had wished her dead rather than among the Mormons. "Mother, I believe it is the will of God for me to go to the West, and I have been convinced that it has been for a long time. Now the way has opened, and you seem to be reconciled to it, which is the greatest consolation to me of anything earthly. I believe that it is the Spirit of the Lord that has done it, which is sufficient for all things. Oh, be not anxious for your child. The Lord will comfort me. I believe that the Lord will take care of me and give me that which is for the best." She reassured her mother that, in accepting Mormonism, she had not rejected her family. "Believe not that all these things are against you, for they are not." Then she added a promise. "Although the ways of Providence seem dark, I shall come home to see you in the first suitable opportunity, whether I like or not." Finally, she offered an explanation for the strange method she had chosen of saying goodbye. "I have taken this method of speaking my mind because it seems easier than verbal conversation. I have written already much more than I expected, so I must bid you goodbye, Father and Mother, for the present." Phoebe's letter should have ended here, but since there was still space left on the second page, she addressed postscripts to her sisters Rhoda, Shua, and Mary, and her brother Fabian, underlining each with a scalloped line. She urged them to obey God, to embrace the light they had been given, and, the implication was clear, to join her in gathering with the saints. The postscripts extended the letter into a long farewell she wasn't able to manage in person, as though she were waving at them from the carriage window as it disappeared around a bend in the road. Brother Fabian and Sister Rhoda, I do know there is peace in obeying the commands of God. Why tarriest thou? Goodbye. Sister Shua, never deny what God has done for you, but ever believe that the kingdom of God has come nigh to you. So I must bid you goodbye until I see you again. Sister Mary, I must say to you, be not discouraged, but be diligent in keeping all the commands of God, and it will be well with you, and you shall receive a great reward. Goodbye. P. If the letter overreached in its preaching, that was surely because the decision to leave had been so difficult. Only by enlisting God as her ally could Phoebe muster the courage to break with all that she knew. As she later recalled, in the year 1834, I embraced the gospel. And, about a year after, I left my parents and kindred and journeyed to Kirtland, Ohio, a distance of 1,000 miles, a lone maid. A lone maid. In Kirtland, Phoebe, like Wilford, understood herself as a sojourner among strangers. She wasn't the only unmarried woman to join the saints, nor was she the only female to travel from the far northeast. But, taken together, her single status and the distance she had come set her apart. Eliza Snow, who was already establishing a reputation among the saints as a poet, was single, but she had only moved 20 or 30 miles from her home in Mantua, Ohio. Caroline Crosby, a convert exactly the same age as Phoebe, had traveled more than 800 miles from a village near Montreal, Canada, but, like most of Kirtland's adult women, she came with a husband. Zena Huntington, who was almost 14 years younger than Phoebe, arrived with both parents, two younger siblings, and a married brother and sister. A few years later, Eliza, Caroline, and Zena would each begin a diary. Phoebe never did. Her life has to be constructed from the one kept by her husband and from scattered letters between them. A broader sense of what it meant for the early saints to gather to Kirtland can be gleaned from the blessings that Joseph Smith Sr., the prophet's father, gave them. In an era of massive migration, converts sought not only spiritual substance, but ways of healing ruptures in human relationships. Technically, a patriarchal blessing should have come from the recipient's own father, but many had no fathers. Through his calling as patriarch, Father Smith replaced the literal fathers who had died or resisted conversion. More than half of the 341 blessings he gave in Kirtland between 1835 and 1837 went to men destined to take up priesthood callings, but 130, 38%, went to women. Some women received their blessings alongside their husbands, but about a quarter appear to have been, like Phoebe, alone. The patriarch consistently promised single women, especially those in their teens or twenties, that they would find companions. Sometimes his prophecies took only a few months to fulfill. 23-year-old Eliza Brown received her blessing in May 1935 and was married to William Perry in October. Perhaps blessing meetings, like the one Wilford attended with Abraham Smoot, helped to facilitate such an outcome. But for some Kirtland women, the problem was not being single, but being legally bound to a man who had deserted them, or the church. Father Smith told Susan Wells, age 28, "Thou art in affliction for thy husband, for he is in the world, his faith is shaken. Thy heart aches and is concerned for him." He promised her that, through her prayers, her husband might yet become a man of God. More difficult was the situation of women who had themselves fled alcoholic or abusive spouses. Lydia Goldwaite was only 24 when she ran away to her parents' house, then, fearful that her husband would seek revenge, fled to Canada, where she met Mormon missionaries and, with Joseph Smith's blessing, married Newell K. Knight. Although in the eyes of the law this was a bigamous marriage, the prophet's father assured her that God understood her sorrow and had blessed this union. "Thou hast been afflicted much in thy past days, and thy heart has been pained. Many tears have fallen from thine eyes, and thou hast wept much," he began. He promised her in the name of God that this marriage would last. "The Lord loves thee, and has given thee a kind and loving companion for thy comfort, and your souls shall be knit together, and nothing shall be able to dissolve them, neither distress nor death shall separate you." Since there had been no divorce, her marriage to Knight was illegal, but in this community, obeying God sometimes meant disobeying the laws of man. In situations like this, religious affirmation helped to ease anxiety and guilt. In a later memoir, Eliza Snow euphemistically described her sister Leonora Levitt as a young widow when she came to Kirtland. Actually, she too had left her husband, abandoning her son and bringing her two daughters with her to her parents' home. In June 1836, Father Smith blessed one of these daughters, 10-year-old Lucia Louisa Levitt, telling her that, though she was, as it were, an orphan in the world, the Lord had looked upon her mother and blessed her. Evidence of a more startling incident of family disruption emerges from the blessing Father Smith gave to Nancy Richardson in 1837. "Because you have obeyed the commands of your heavenly Father, come out of Babylon and brought these little children with you to this place that you might have a better opportunity of knowing the minds and will of God, thou shalt be blessed, and these children shall grow up and be a comfort and a blessing to you, and thou shalt have thy sister, the mother of these children, to help you take care of them." Apparently, Richardson had brought two of her younger sister's children with her from Connecticut, intending to raise them as her own. Family tradition says that one of those children, when grown, tried to reconnect with his parents unsuccessfully. Was this an adoption or an abduction? It is not clear. What is certain is that Richardson herself was single, a mother but not a wife. Yet in the patriarch's view, her faith qualified her for the blessings of salvation. Father Smith showed compassion for women who felt bound by the patriarchal authority of husbands or fathers. He told Sophronia Hinckley, "Thou art an orphan. Thy father was opposed to the truth and did not come into the kingdom and is now gone from the earth, and thou art at liberty to follow the Lord." His promises of future blessings were often stunning in their specificity. He promised Mariah Crandall that she not only would see Jesus return in a cloud, but would receive 40 days' notice of his arrival. He told 20-year-old Mary Baldwin that she, like the biblical Mary, would experience the ministry of angels, and that she would someday teach the daughters of the Lamanites, an apparent reference to the Native Americans, whose lineage Mormons trace to the Book of Mormon. He told Esther Lorraine Brown that, though she may have sinned in her heart, she was innocent. As a daughter of Abraham, she would bear children who would become prophets and prophetesses. At a blessing meeting held in the temple on November 10, 1836, Father Smith put his hands on Phoebe Carter's head and said things she probably wasn't even able to say to herself. "Thou hast suffered, by being deprived of friends unto whom thou couldst unbosom thy mind. Thou hast sorrowed in the night season and in solitary places. No one knew thy sorrow or saw thy tears but God thy Father. Phoebe had apparently been less confident when she arrived in Kirtland than when she wrote her farewell letter to her family. The patriarch assured her that even the most devout Christian might find it difficult to part with those they loved. "Be comforted," he said, "for thy troubles are over, and God will pour out his blessings to thee." He prophesied that her future husband would be a man of wisdom, knowledge, and understanding, and that her children would be ornaments to the church. Since Wilford had not yet arrived in Kirtland, Father Smith cannot have had him in mind. Wilford later recorded the date of Phoebe's blessing in his diary. Father Smith also prophesied that Phoebe would sew the veil of the temple, and if she remained faithful, see all her relatives become members of the covenant. Phoebe never said what it was that filled her soul with such certainty that she was willing to leave her home and family. Conversion surely involved what Latter-day Saints called personal revelation, but it was also a social process. Wilford's oddly formal announcement that he had met Phoebe at Elder Milliken's by the politeness of Elder M. Holmes suggests that, even in a town of fewer than 2,000 inhabitants, social networks mattered. Milton Holmes had marched with Wilford in Zion's camp and, like him, had returned from a mission to become a member of the Quorum of 70. Nathaniel Milliken was also a 70, and he and his wife, Mary, were from the same part of Maine as Phoebe. Perhaps they had traveled together to Kirtland. However it happened, the little Mormon community in Ohio brought together a 30-year-old man from Connecticut and a 30-year-old woman from Maine, a couple who would have been unlikely to meet had they remained in their home states. In 1837, there was as yet no hint that Joseph Smith would, within a few years, radically revise the meaning of marriage among the Latter-day Saints, not only by declaring it essential for salvation, but by proclaiming plural marriage or polygamy as the divine order. In the year when Phoebe and Wilford were married, Mormon ceremonies looked pretty much like other marriage ceremonies elsewhere in the rural United States, except that they seemed more egalitarian. Husband and wife took identical vows. He stood on the right, she on the left, and as directed by the Holy Spirit, the officiator called each by name and asked if both mutually agree to be each other's companion, husband and wife, observing the legal rights belonging to this condition, that is, keeping yourselves holy for each other and from all others during your lives. If they answered yes, the officiator pronounced them husband and wife, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by virtue of the laws of the country. That was all. The congregation might sing a hymn, family and friends might serve wine and cake, but there was no giving the bride away, no ring, no veil, and apparently no promise to obey. After performing such a wedding, Joseph Smith wrote in his own diary, "I doubt whether the pages of history can boast of a more splendid and innocent wedding and feast than this, for it was conducted after the order of heaven." For Latter-day Saints, the order of heaven came not from the ceremony itself, but from the authority of the man who performed it. Even though he acted under the laws of Ohio, he held a holy priesthood that gave him the right to speak in the name of God. Wilford and Phoebe were married at the prophet's house on April 13, 1837, at 2 in the afternoon. Another couple was married at 4, and then the whole company, consisting of about 16 couple, walked to a nearby home to witness a third wedding. No day more pleasing than April 13th, 1837, Wilford wrote, straining for imagery worthy of the occasion. The sun in the east arose to gladden earth and shed o'er nature his pleasing beams to welcome the return of delighted spring that dreary winter might be forgotten. The illusion was odd. According to his diary, the winter had not been dreary at all. From all appearances, he had experienced one long succession of religious rapture. Still, the contrast between spring and winter was a ready-made metaphor, so he used it. While all nature smiled without, friendship's purest joys were felt beneath a prophet's roof. Yes, friendship. That was the right word to describe not only the sort of companionship he and Phoebe would have, but the joy they felt in being married in a room surrounded by other Latter-day Saints. Then his tone shifted. Was there, perhaps, a dark spot in this otherwise perfect day? The wedding had taken place in the prophet's home, but the prophet was not there. Wilford could not ignore that fact, or the hints of future trouble it foreshadowed. The prophet Joseph, from his wife, children, and house, for a moment had fled, had torn himself from their embrace in some lonely place to seek a shelter to escape the bloodthirsty Gentiles' hands against him raised for bearing the testimony of Jesus Christ. The prophet's father, who performed the ceremony, assured the brides that their prayers would protect their mates if they, too, were bound in chains and vaults or in prisons cast for the word of God and the testimony of Jesus, suggesting that the fate that befell the prophet on that April day might also fall upon them. O heaven, protect the four, Wilford wrote, closing his meditation with a Latin flourish. Vera amicitia est sempiterna. True friendship is eternal. Wilford knew that he was about to leave Kirkland to serve for the second time as a missionary. On May 31, 1837, he took the parting hand with the saints in Kirkland, prepared to go again into the vineyard to proclaim the word of God. Phoebe was going too, though the two of them would travel separately, she by coach and canal boat, he mostly walking, preaching along the way. In Connecticut, Wilford would try to reconnect with his family. In Maine, Phoebe would for a time sleep under a paternal roof with her husband beside her. A mission to New England. Wilford's return to Connecticut became a sentimental journey that led him backward to scenes of youth and early childhood. On June 4, a Sunday, he and two companions walked to his brother Asmund Woodruff's farm in Oswego County, New York, where he sensed something of a coldness manifest towards me, especially from Asmund's wife Elizabeth. She gave the missionaries supper, but refused them a place to sleep. Perhaps she was angry that Wilford had abandoned the farm. Oh, scenes of life, how variant, how transient, how painful thou art, Wilford wrote. He prayed that Asmund might regain his faith, but he could not bring himself to leave a blessing either in English or in his newly acquired Hebrew. Kin after the flesh were not always kindred in spirit, he wrote. Things went a bit better in Connecticut. On June 22nd, he found his half-sister Eunice teaching school near the mill their father had once managed. We saluted each other with a hearty shake of the hand, he wrote, adding in shorthand, and a kiss. Eunice was only 12 when her brothers left for New York. She was now a young woman in her teens. He spent a day in her light-filled school, struggling with his emotions. While she taught, he read a packet of letters she had received from their 23-year-old brother, Asahel, the last of Azuba's surviving sons, who was seeking his fortune in Indiana. Reading the letters, Wilford smiled and wept, thinking of their brother Philo, who had died at about the age Eunice was now. I beheld my sister, my only sister, 17 years of age, adorned with youth, modesty, and loveliness, her face veiled with the true picture of Philo. His melancholy deepened as he and Eunice walked through the town of Colebrook. They visited their parents' former dwelling at Sage's Mills. The house was now silent as death. While Eunice plucked a rose, Wilford dropped a tear. Wilford's romantic longing had multiple sources. Reading Asahel's letters had awakened his desire to see a brother who, for a time, had shared his own religious quest. Seeing the empty house reminded him of his father's struggle to launch his sons. After mortgaging his property to purchase more land, he had lost possession of the mill he had once owned in Avon, sliding downward from owner to hired operative. Of Afek's living children, only Eunice remained in Connecticut. From Colebrook, Wilford moved on to Avon. Here were more scenes to remind him of times passing. He took the path along the Farmington Canal to mills built and formerly owned by my father. Then he walked by the house where he was born and the schoolhouse where he had spent so many youthful days, to the graveyard in which lay the bones of many of my progenitors and friends. He copied the inscription on his mother's stone. A pleasing form, a generous, gentle heart, a good companion, just without art, just in her dealings, faithful to her friend, beloved through life, lamented in the end. Beulah Woodruff was 26 years old when she died, 4 years younger than Wilford and Phoebe were now. At Farmington, Wilford's father and stepmother, Azuba, made him heartily welcome. He spent the next week going back and forth to nearby towns, preaching in private homes, schoolhouses, and occasionally a church. In Collinsville, a crowd tried to drum him out of the city hall, but in Avon, his old friends and some of his extended kin were kind enough, or perhaps simply curious enough, to listen respectfully. On July 11, he preached at the Lovely Street Schoolhouse in Avon. He and his uncle Ozum and Aunt Hannah Woodruff and their son John stayed up late talking religion. At 2 o'clock a.m., they told Wilford they believed the fullness of the everlasting gospel. And he led them forth at the same hour of the night and baptized them for the remission of their sins. Wilford felt certain this was a fulfillment of a vision he had received when still a child. When he got back to his parents' home in Farmington, he found a letter from Phoebe. After 10 days' journey, she had at last arrived at Canaan, in the far corner of Connecticut, where she had expected to meet him. Since she was fatigued from her journey, and no one could predict whether Wilford was coming back, she thought she would stay a few days. She added in a postscript, "Don't let anyone see this sad-looking letter, for I am in great haste and have a bad pen and no Wilford to mend it." In truth, both her penmanship and her spelling were better than her husband's, though he usually had more to say. Phoebe arrived in Farmington in time to hear him preach at the schoolhouse on July 16. On July 21, they took the parting hand with his parents and began the next leg of their journey. They took a stage together to Hartford, then Phoebe continued toward Maine, while Wilford walked through central Massachusetts toward the New Hampshire coast, preaching and holding meetings along the way. On August 8, they met in Scarborough, Maine. Unlike the Woodruffs, the Carters had retained their ancestral perch. Their house, built in 1815, stood on land inherited from Phoebe's maternal grandfather, Joshua Fabian, a man remembered in Scarborough as Squire Fabian because of his service as Justice of the Court of Common Sessions in York County. The house was an imposing, though somewhat conservative, building for its time, with chimneys on both ends, a Georgian facade, and wide floorboards and wainscoting made from old-growth pine. Mature apple trees and elms surrounded it. The names the Carters gave their children show the importance they attached to both sides of the family. All the sons received their mother's maiden name as a middle name, although only Joseph Fabian was routinely called Fabian. Phoebe was named Phoebe Whitmore Carter for her paternal grandmother. Sarah was Sarah Brackett Carter for her mother's mother. After the quiet house in Farmington, the Carter home must have seemed full indeed. Phoebe's widowed sister, Sarah Foss, and her seven children were there when Phoebe and Wilfred arrived, as were Fabian and his wife and daughter, and the three sisters still at home, Rhoda, Shua, and Mary. "It was an affecting meeting," Wilfred wrote. 2 days later, Phoebe's brother Ezra and his wife arrived from Portland. The only one missing was Illis, who at age 20 may have been at sea. Unlike Wilfred, Phoebe had grown up in a region that was gaining rather than losing population. While Connecticut had stagnated, Maine had more than doubled in size since 1810, though by 1840, Ohio far outstripped all the New England states. Wilfred, who was an avid trout fisherman, took an excursion with Phoebe's brothers and for the first time saw a fish belonging to that kind that swallowed Jonah. Since Father Smith had promised him he would preach on the islands of the sea, he was determined to love the ocean. But in a shorthand addendum, he admitted to being somewhat seasick. In mid-August 1837, he headed for the Fox Islands and Penobscot Bay. Although he pronounced the South Island as near being without any form or void as any land I ever saw, he found the inhabitants generally wealthy, healthy, intelligent, industrious, generous, and hospitable to strangers. He wrote of sailing through what seemed to him acres of leaping fish and later bathing in salt water surrounded by seals. The harvest of souls was just as impressive. He and his companion held meetings in schoolhouses, in fields, and even in the Baptist meeting house, boasting a full house on a Sabbath when the regular pastor had not one soul beside himself. Wilfred believed he knew the reason. The Spirit of God is like leaven through the island. In October, he went back to Scarborough and collected Phoebe, thrilled to have a bosom friend and a helpmeet to share his work. She remained with him through the autumn and winter of 1837 to 1838. When he was discouraged, she cheered him. When he was ill, she healed him by the laying on of hands. His reference to the healing, written in shorthand, is important evidence that in the 1830s, Latter-day Saint women were already engaged in a spiritual practice that, though challenged, would be affirmed by Joseph Smith in Nauvoo. Phoebe was still with him when a new male companion arrived. Joseph Ball was a Bostonian, the son of a Jamaican immigrant of mixed racial descent who had, in 1796, helped found the African Society, a voluntary association and mutual aid society. Although Ball's father was deceased by the time he accepted Mormonism, his mother, who was white, was still living. His sisters, Lucy and Martha Ball, were active in the Boston Female Anti-Slavery Society. If Woodruff was at all concerned about Ball's racial heritage, he did not show it, nor did it have any effect on the success of their mission. When the two men left to preach in another part of the island, Phoebe kept them informed about events in her area, sometimes with a bit of humor, as on March 1, 1838, when she told Wilfred that the saints in Vinylhaven had had a good meeting and that Brother Crockett was wide awake. As the crowds grew, Wilfred saw signs in the heavens telling him that the second coming was at hand. Small miracles testified that God was gathering the blood of Israel from all nations. One prospective convert accepted baptism when a very large fish, seldom seen near shore, unaccountably swam straight toward him as if to summon him to baptism. By March, Wilford and Joseph Ball had gathered as many as 100 converts on an island with fewer than 2,000 inhabitants. This success did not come without opposition. On January 13, somebody shot off a cannon outside their meeting. 3 days later, they heard gunshots. During a sermon in a schoolhouse, people of the baser sort deliberately disrupted by walking across the house and talking, whistling, singing, dancing, etc. The missionaries also experienced an indignity suffered by the prophet Elisha, who was mocked by little children. Unlike their biblical predecessor, they did not call on bears to devour their tormentors. Instead, they washed their own feet in pure water as a testament against all those who rejected their message, including the Methodist and Baptist preachers on the islands. It wasn't local opposition, however, but trouble in Kirtland that ended their mission. In the year after the Woodruffs left Kirtland, the bank failed, debts came due, and once loyal members left the church. As the community crumbled, Joseph Smith and his family fled Ohio for Missouri. Opening a letter from Kirtland rimmed in black, Phoebe was astonished to learn that many of their old friends were among the dissenters. "But I hope not Wilford and Phoebe," she wrote in a hasty letter to her husband. The disaffections were worse than she imagined. Although Kirtland had almost 2,000 inhabitants by 1837, the church lost between 10 and 15% of its membership, and as many as a third of its general officers, including 4 of the 12 apostles. In Phoebe's words, "I think that these times will try the faith of the saints." Phoebe, who was 6 months pregnant, realized that her days as a missionary were limited. On April 17, she boarded a ship for Scarborough. Over the next few days, Wilford and Joseph Ball visited church members to tell them that the time had come to gather to Zion. Then they, too, headed south. Walking most of the way to save money, they arrived at the Carter House on April 30 with painfully blistered feet. They rested briefly, then set out on a different kind of mission. Hoping to encourage Latter-day Saints scattered along the Atlantic coast, from Massachusetts to New Jersey, to join the prophet in Missouri. On May 11, 1838, after a 3-day journey by foot from Portsmouth, New Hampshire, the two men arrived in Boston. "No day of my life was ever attended with more of a change of circumstances and places which my eyes beheld and ears heard and heart felt than on this day," Wilford wrote. This Connecticut native had never seen Boston. He walked on the Revolutionary War entrenchment on Bunker Hill, then visited the Navy Yard in Charleston, perused the new market built by Mayor Josiah Quincy, and climbed to the cupola of the State House on Beacon Hill. After satisfying his curiosity as a tourist, he walked over the bridge from Boston to Cambridge to visit Albert Rockwood, a fellow Mormon who was imprisoned for debt in the Middlesex County Jail. Like common people everywhere, Rockwood was suffering the consequences of a widespread economic depression triggered by the Panic of 1837. Wilford did his best to comfort him. After leaving the jail, Wilford had an experience common to Boston visitors. "Crossed into the city, and being alone, and a stranger, and in the darkness of the night, I lost my way." He eventually found Myrtle Street, where a small gathering of Latter-day Saints was waiting at the home of an upholsterer named Polly Vose. This was his first experience with a primarily female branch of the church. He did not list names, but his diary entries over the next few days refer to several meetings with the Sisters of the Church. Indeed, it was women, some of whom ran boarding houses in Boston in the 1830s, who spread the good news of Mormonism among their friends and associates, laying the foundation for a lively branch of the church that sent zealous converts west, including Augusta Adams Cobb and Vienna Jacques, who will appear later in our story. On June 8, Wilford parted with Joseph Ball at Fishkill, New York, and began a 3-day journey on foot through a rough and mountainous part of Connecticut to his father's house in Farmington. On July 1, he baptized his father, his mother, his sister Eunice, his cousin Seth Woodruff, his aunt Anna Cossett, and a hired hand named Dwight Webster. Then he organized the whole group, along with Uncle Ozum, Aunt Hannah, and Cousin John Woodruff, whom he had baptized the year before, into the Farmington branch of the church. For him, this was the crowning achievement of his year in New England. On July 3, he said goodbye to his parents, walked through 90-degree heat to Worcester, Massachusetts, and boarded a train to Boston and a ship to Portland, Maine. After stopping at Phoebe's brother Ezra Carter's store in Portland to buy an autograph album for Phoebe, he arrived in Scarborough on July 6, relieved to know that he had not missed the delivery of his first child. While waiting for the birth, he worked on transforming the rough notes he had taken on his journey into his diary. By the blood of Christ united. Wilford's retrospective account of the events of July 1, 1838, began as in an ordinary diary entry with the month, day, and year. Then he fell into a kind of rhapsody. On this seventh month, the first day of the month and the first day of the week, which is called Sunday, some of the most important events transpired with me that I ever witnessed since I had a being. Events worthy to be recorded upon the archives of heaven, or to be engraved with an iron pen and laid in a rock forever upon the earth. The distinction he drew between heavenly archives and earthly records captured the paradoxical nature of Mormon revelation. Joseph Smith claimed to have translated the Book of Mormon from metal plates excavated from an actual hill in upstate New York. But he also said that an angel led him to the plates, then took them away when the translation was complete. To Latter-day Saints, revelation from heaven was recorded on earth, and events recorded on earth were marked in heaven. In the two pages that followed, Wilford used his own pen to give material shape to sacred things. On the left-hand page, inside an arched frame, he described the baptism of his parents, packing more than 800 words into a framed space about the size of a 3x5 card. It is almost impossible to read it without a magnifying glass. Perhaps he used one to create it. Although he prayed that God would direct his pen, he also relied on a straight edge and compass, using techniques taught in academies like the one he had attended in Connecticut. On the right-hand page, inside a ruffled circle, he wrote the names of the new members of the Farmington branch of the church, adding an ornamental swirl typical of those used by village calligraphers. The result was a family record that acknowledged kinship both of blood and by faith. Wilford had administered the ordinance of baptism to a father, a mother, an only sister, and to Dwight Webster, who was not of consanguine blood to me. The members of the newly created circle were by the blood of Christ united. Wilford believed that the baptisms of his relatives fulfilled a promise made in the House of the Lord in Kirtland on April 15, 1837. On that day, the prophet's father and patriarch of the church told him that if he lived by faith, he might bring all of his friends, that is, his relatives, into the kingdom of God. That promise extended beyond present and past generations into the future. Thy sons shall receive the priesthood and be an ornament to the church of Christ, the patriarch said. As he laid out the pages describing the baptisms in Connecticut, Wilford was surely thinking of these words. He may also have remembered the papyrus he had seen in the attic of the temple, writings he believed had been left by Abraham himself. In one of them, a particularly compelling set of hieroglyphics sat within a tightly drawn circle. Wilford struggled to express with his pen a union of heaven and earth, of spiritual and biological kinship, and, beyond that, a new relationship between priesthood and progeny. On July 14, 1838, at 5:30 in the morning, Phoebe passed through that scene of sickness which is common among women in every age of the world, and delivered a healthy baby girl. Wilford celebrated the occasion by creating another ornamented circle, this one on the first page of the album he had bought Phoebe in Portland. Inside, he wrote her name and the date. On a separate diary entry, he prophesied, "Our daughter Sarah Emma, in half an hour after she was born, performed a journey in the arms of Sister Sarah Foss through the garret, chambers, and lower room, and principally through the whole house. Is not this an omen of her being an extensive traveler in her day?" For Wilford, the baby's introduction to her grandparents' house was a prophecy that she would soon abandon it. As soon as Phoebe and the baby were ready to travel, the Woodruffs planned to leave for Missouri with as many of the Fox Island saints as they could gather. Over the next few days, Wilford helped Phoebe's sister Sarah Foss with haying, then headed back to the islands to make sure that his little flock were prepared to join the migration. While there, he received a letter that increased his sense of urgency. He had been called to the Quorum of the 12 Apostles and was expected to gather at the temple site in far west Missouri on April 26, 1839, and from there, depart for other climes across the mighty deep. The date set by Revelation was less than 8 months away, and the journey to far west was more than 1,000 miles. He and Phoebe had no time to lose. Back in Scarborough, he found a letter from his brother Asahel that filled his soul with rapture. "I now find my brother earnestly inquiring what he shall do to be saved, and searching deep for light and truth with a desire to embrace it." Surely this was an additional omen that it was right for them to begin the journey without delay. If all went well, he and Phoebe would be able to visit Asahel in Indiana on their way. Wilford went to work to prepare for the journey. He built a 2.5 by 3 foot box, which he filled with 300 pounds of goods, perhaps things considered part of Phoebe's marriage portion. In addition, Father Carter gave the young couple $100, for which they signed an article or writing that we were satisfied and would hold no further claim against the estate. Meanwhile, Wilford used his calligraphy skills to make family records for Phoebe's brother Fabian and her sister Sarah Foss, and an acrostic for her sister Shua. He went fishing with Father Carter and Fabian, landing the boat on a rocky outcropping where they fried out pork in an iron pot, then added some of the fish they had caught, along with potatoes, crackers, and seasoning, exclaiming that it was what seamen or fishermen call a chowder. Wilford proclaimed it as rich a dish as would be necessary to set before a king, adding that they all sat down and ate uncommonly hearty, using clamshells for knives, forks, and spoons. Back on shore on the last day of summer, he and Phoebe gathered seashells and barberry berries to carry to the land of Zion for domestic use and in memory of the place. The family idyll was disrupted when 2-month-old Sarah Emma came down with a severe attack of the whooping cough. Given the baby's illness, Phoebe's family questioned the propriety of our gathering with the saints to Zion. The arguments grew more intense when local newspapers reported that Mormons had clashed with non-Mormons on Election Day in Davies County, Missouri, and that mobs had arisen to drive them out of the state. My trials are as great about these days as at any time since I have been a member of The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, Wilford admitted, engaging in a kind of dialogue with himself. Had his faith failed him? No, God forbid. What was the matter then? I'll tell you. The Lord has commanded me to go to Zion speedily, and while I am setting myself about it, the devil with all his agents are using their combined exertions and power to hinder me. Would he give up? Of course not. Packing seeds from Father Carter's apples into a box, he vowed that he would plant them in Zion. On October 3, 8 families and 1 single male from the Fox Islands hove in sight. The next day, Phoebe, Wilford, and the Maine Pilgrims packed themselves into 10 wagons pulled by 19 horses and began their journey. The first night, they camped 13 miles down the Maine coast near a sawmill. It was for a moment a trial to my feelings to take my tender wife with an infant at her breast into a cold tent to sleep upon the ground, Wilford wrote. A nearby family came to their rescue, offering Phoebe and her infant a place in their house. Wilford lay down in the tent, but he couldn't sleep. After taking his turn standing watch, he opened his diary. I sat up the remainder of the night, built up a fire, and wrote these lines by it. One by one, as they moved farther west, the converts they had brought with them dropped out, hoping to find temporary work and shelter for the winter, each promising to catch up with the others in the spring. In Indiana, Phoebe succumbed to what Wilford called brain fever, a headache so severe that she could not endure the jostling of the wagon. Terrified that she would die, he found a place for them to stay, then anointed her with oil, and with all the power of his priesthood, rebuked the destroyer. Phoebe revived, telling him that at the height of her illness, her spirit seemed to leave her body, and she saw herself lying in bed with her sisters weeping around her as 2 messengers came into the room carrying a coffin. They told her she had a choice. She could go to rest in the spirit world, or she could continue upon the earth, but only on the condition that she agree to stand by her husband through all the cares, trials, tribulations, and afflictions he would be called upon to endure for the gospel's sake. She chose to stay with him. Renewed in faith, they pushed on, hoping to reach Terre Haute, Indiana, where Wilford's brother Asahel ran a bookstore. Less than a day's travel from their destination, they spotted a newspaper story reporting Asahel's death. Wilford drew a coffin across a page of his diary, then penned a lamentation. O Asahel, among strangers thy lot was cast. Among them thou hast fallen and found a grave. His only comfort was in securing his brother's journals and letters, objects he considered of more value than the gold of Ophir or the rubies of Peru. As the Woodruffs moved into Illinois, they learned that even if they wanted to join the besieged saints in Missouri, they could not. The ice over the Missouri River was frozen fast, and no ferries were running. During the last week of December, they settled into a rented house near Rochester, Illinois, in a grove of woods on the borders of a prairie. Still determined to reach Missouri by spring, Wilford went to work to support them, pronouncing their short stay in Illinois, "the first of my housekeeping." 2. There was many sick among the saints. From the Half-Breed Tract to the British Mission, 1839 to 1841. The Mormon troubles in Missouri in 1838 and 1839 were the culmination of a conflict reaching back to July 1833, When Jackson County vigilantes destroyed the church printing press at Independence, tarred and feathered their bishop, and demanded that Mormon settlers leave the county. Taking refuge across the river in neighboring Clay County, the Saints sought redress for their loss of land. When that failed, they accepted an offer from the state to take up new land in northwestern Missouri. This solution might have worked if the call to gather had not been so successful. In 1838, families from Kirtland joined new converts in Missouri, eager to make a fresh start. The first clash in the new counties occurred on Election Day on August 8, 1838. Armed conflict followed, leading to a battle at Crooked River in October, in which one Missourian and three Mormons, including Apostle David Patton, were killed. A few days later, Governor Lilburn Boggs issued his infamous executive order demanding that the Mormons be exterminated or driven from the state. Missourians, many of whom were new settlers themselves, had no desire to see a new Jerusalem rise in their midst, especially one inhabited by people they perceived to be northern fanatics. During the winter of 1839, between 8,000 and 10,000 Saints fled Missouri, traveling eastward 150 miles across frozen prairie to find refuge in nearby states. Many found temporary quarters in Quincy, Illinois, where the Woodruffs joined them in the spring. By summer, the church had a new gathering place 50 miles upriver from Quincy at a town called Commerce. Despite its hopeful name, Commerce had few habitable buildings. People took shelter in wagon boxes, tents, or crude wickiups made from oak, hazel, or blackberry brush. Some, including the Woodruffs, moved into an abandoned army barracks across the Mississippi in Montrose, Iowa, a place known in a government treaty with the Sauk Fox Indians as the Half-Breed Tract. Malaria was endemic on both sides of the river. In Mormon literature, two sets of faith-promoting stories emerge from this period. The first, which originated in Wilford's diary, tells how, on July 22, 1839, he called it a day of God's power, the prophet Joseph rose from his sickbed in Commerce to heal those who were suffering. There was many sick among the saints on both sides of the river, and Joseph went through the midst of them, taking them by the hand, and in a loud voice commanding them in the name of Jesus Christ to arise from their beds and be made whole, and they leaped from their beds made whole by the power of God. Later versions added Wilford himself to the story, explaining that when a non-Mormon settler begged the prophet to ride 2 miles back into the prairie to bless his infant twins who were dying, Joseph gave Wilford his red silk handkerchief and told him to go with the man, promising that if he stroked the baby's faces with the handkerchief, they too would be healed. And, according to these long-cherished tales, they were. Today, a silk handkerchief said to have belonged to Joseph Smith is in the Woodruff collection in the Church Museum. These narratives show what God might do for his saints. A second set of stories explains what the saints might do for God. Members of the Quorum of the 12 Apostles had risked their lives by going back into Missouri in secret to meet on April 26, 1839, at the site of the unbuilt temple at Far West. During this secret meeting, Wilford was ordained an apostle. With the others, he promised to go over the great waters to England to promulgate the gospel. When the time came to leave, he and most of the others were prostrate with malaria. Yet, one by one, they dragged themselves out of bed and began the journey. Somehow, they made it across the Atlantic, reaping the harvest of souls that within a few years revived the weakened church. The 4,600 English converts who migrated to America helped transform swamp-ridden commerce into the thriving city of Nauvoo, a name derived from a Hebrew word for beautiful. For believers, the account of how Joseph Smith sent his most talented and reliable leaders to England.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.